everyone. I'm Dr. Mini Salunkhe. I'm a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist at Cloudnine Hospitals, Pune, Kalyani Nagar. At the outset, let me wish all my viewers a very, very happy Women's Day. Naturally, as everyone knows, this is a very special day for all of us. Today, I'm here to solve many of your queries on common gynec issues in a woman, faced by a woman. So, here we would discuss many of the common gynec issues. Our viewers have already started floating some questions. So we will start by answering some of these questions. So the first viewer has asked the question, her name is Rakhi, which is the most common concern in adulthood? Hi Rakhi, I wish you a very happy Women's Day. Let me get down basically to the question which you have asked. What is the most common concern in adulthood? As a woman is attaining puberty and she's going into her adulthood, as I see it, the most common concern girls would have is basically, are my periods regular? If they become irregular, will this have any fertility issues? Then is there any problem of fertility and pregnancy? You know, if there is a pain in the abdomen, am I suffering from painful periods? Is the reason something pathological like ovarian cysts or fibroids or endometriosis? So I know there are many burning problems in the adulthood nowadays, and which I see commonly is polycystic ovarian syndrome or disease. Then we have ovarian cysts or fibroids affecting the fertility. Sometimes the woman is coming with irregular periods. So I think that these are many of the common concerns which a woman in her adulthood may have. Will I get pregnant? Is my age too much? Is it, you know, if I cross the threshold for fertility? Many of the patients who come to us, you know, they say, doctor, is it the right time? Is it the right age? Am I overage? Do you think, you know, there are so many questions and concerns, because nowadays what happens that we are, the girls take some time to settle down, you know, because of their, they are into their professions. They are careeristic women, but they have to, after the marriage, you know, do their, so many roles are there in front of a woman. And then actually when she comes to us in adulthood, then there are so many problems which she's faced with, and there are some concerns and she's anxious. So when such women, they come to the OPD, they come to us, we tell them that don't worry. Many of the problems, or most of the problems, are easily solvable. Easily, and just see to it that you're having a regular diet, having regular exercise. If there's anything which is of concern, then you can immediately come to the gynecologist and we can sort it out. Here, another thing I would want to let my viewers know is the importance of regular gynec screening when you become an adult. So what happens is that when we enter adulthood, sometimes there are some hidden problems which are not known to us. Especially a preconceptional counseling session is very important, in which, you know, we tell the couple as a whole as to these are the, when we take the history, we tell them, you know, this, the genetic history, the family history, the menstrual history, are you getting regular periods? What are your previous investigations? Are you suffering from anything which can be solved before the pregnancy can be achieved? So I hope, Rakhi, that I have answered this question to your perfection. So I think now we start the next question. Soumya has asked this: why do I get frequent rashes on my genitals? I'm 28 years old. Hello Soumya. The question of rashes on the genitals is something which can be answered by examining you. Because what happens is that rashes on the genital areas may be of different types. There might be a rash simply because there is irritation on the vaginal area, because you had excessive vaginal discharge, you've done a lot of itching on that area. So, you know, because of that, there has some rash has come up. Secondly, the other type of rashes may be genital herpes. There are warts, there are rashes also, there are ulcerations on the genitals which have to be treated accordingly. So other type of rashes are because of some inherent infections inside the uterus which have come outside in the form of discharge or itching. So here it is important that you visit your gynecologist. Let her see that external area, let her examine you internally as well as externally, and then sort it out. The next question has been asked by Ritika: how do periods affect our gynae hygiene? So Ritika, here the periods are a natural way of the uterus, you know, uterus and the debris inside the uterus and the this is the natural way of, you know, cleaning the uterus. Now, in the process of this cleaning of the uterus, the menstrual blood is coming out. Now, this menstrual blood is generally, we say that this menstrual blood is very clean. But sometimes what happens, if you are suffering from some infection of the uterus or the surrounding organs, this menstrual blood may be slightly foul smelling. Or supposing a woman has excessive menstruation, you know, frequent, very heavy periods, or there is a lot of clotting, or she is having frequent periods in which, you know, she has to change her pads very, very frequently. So in such cases, in such women what happens is that the periods do affect the gynae hygiene by causing rashes. Sometimes there is the diaper rash or the pad rash on the vulva, on the genitals, external genitals. If this bleeding is excessive or it is foul smelling and infected, then again it might lead to some infection, burning or inflammation on the outer parts. Some women are used to using tampons. So tampons also, or pads in general, we tell you to change your pads very frequently if there is heavy menstruation, maybe 2 to 3 hours also. Sometimes tampons which are used, the one of the things that we usually tell our women is that you must change the tampons every 4 to 6 hours. It is very healthy for you to do that so that the surrounding area remains clean. So this is the way the periods may affect our gynae hygiene. The next question I am taking up is from Vaishali. She says that, ma'am, in the last few months I am facing some problems with my periods. I am 24 years old and married girl. Sometimes it is just spotting the whole month, or sometimes it goes on for more than 10 to 12 days in the month. I have thyroid problem, but it is in the range, and there is a little pain in the stomach every time I menstruate or have bleeding. So Vaishali, this problem which you are suffering from is irregular periods. Sometimes what happens is that this, I want to know whether, I mean, you know, sometimes when such a, like you, if you come to the OPD, the first question we would have asked you is that, Vaishali, when did your periods first start? And have your periods been regular right from the beginning? Is it that only in the past 1 year that this problem has come up? So sometimes this problem comes up because of irregular menstruation, comes up because of some hormonal issues like polycystic ovaries. Now, polycystic ovaries is a hormonal issue in which irregular periods are there. Sometimes the woman has delayed periods, or sometimes the periods, they come on time, but the woman keeps on spotting or menstruating throughout her menses. Sometimes they are very delayed, around 30 to 40 days. And when they come after a gap of say 1 or 2 months, then the spotting goes on and on and the periods don't stop. So this is typically a hormonal issue in which there might be some metabolic syndrome associated, like thyroid. You say that you have a hypothyroid condition, but the thyroid is in range, probably you must be on some treatment. When the periods are irregular, there is some amount of pain called dysmenorrhea before or during the periods. So all this is a metabolic syndrome in which there is irregular periods and irregular bleeding. Now, since you're a very young girl, the basic thing I would like to tell you is that you can show your gynecologist the problem, do the tests and the investigations that she advises regarding your hormonal profile. How are your hormones? What is the sonography like? You must do a sonography of the pelvis and the abdomen to check whether the uterus and the ovaries, and if there is any lining issue or there is any bleeding issue which is pertaining to the ovaries or the uterus. Are there any fibroids or ovarian cysts? It is unlikely in your age that you would suffer from these problems. But polycystic ovaries is one of the burning problems which we see in our OPD in a day-to-day practice. So Vaishali, what I would advise you is that you go to your gynecologist and get some of the investigations like sonography and test for hormones done. After that, she might tell you to, she might take out your BMI, that is the basal metabolic index, the height is to the weight ratio. And if you're on the little healthier side, there might be some dietitian reviews regarding what type of diet you should eat and what exercises you should be doing on a daily basis. Lifestyle modification would become very important in such a case. Now in this, the basic diagnosis would be what is the reason for your irregular periods. If the reason is polycystic ovaries or hormonal imbalance, it is very easily, I wouldn't say totally curable, but it is, we can to a large extent kind of keep it on hold by giving you some therapies like, you know, hormonal therapies, or just by diet and exercise, we can manage to settle you down, make your periods regular, and change the lifestyle into a healthy lifestyle. The same question has been asked in a different way by one of the other viewers, Sonali. She says anemic periods. That means, anemic means irregular periods. So Sonali, I think that whatever I told Vaishali about the irregular periods holds true for all the women who are suffering from irregular periods. And I hope that this has kind of given you an insight into the irregular periods and what you should be doing henceforth. One of the viewers, Chanchal Jattab, her query is, why does my stomach pain like a pregnancy but the test has come negative? So here, Chanchal, what I gauge from your question is that your periods have not come probably, and the urine pregnancy test is negative, but there is pain in the stomach, which is like the premenstrual cramps that you would have experienced before your menses. So here what happens is that premenstrual cramps can mimic pregnancy symptoms as well. Pregnancy symptoms in the sense that if you have missed your period, either your period has been delayed because of a pregnancy, but your urine pregnancy test is negative. Now in such a case, when the woman comes to us, we do advise her to do a blood pregnancy test, because that is much more sensitive than a urine pregnancy test. Sometimes what happens, some women are not menstruating regularly. If they have delayed or irregular periods and then they miss their periods, it is very difficult for the urine pregnancy test sometimes to come positive, because in very, very early pregnancy, the urine pregnancy test may come negative. So the cramp-like stomach pain which you are experiencing may be because of early pregnancy. In case the blood pregnancy test is also negative and still you are having the cramps in the stomach, that means the uterine cramps, then probably it is because of the delayed period and you are not pregnant. In such a case, we should know why you have delayed periods. Whether it is normal, some, you know, just a single episode of hormonal imbalance, or whether this delayed periods is a chronic thing and you are suffering from this off and on. So to diagnose that condition, we would have to do a sonography and give you the proper treatment. There is another viewer of mine, Geeta Garg, who says that her daughter is 14 years old, but her periods have not started yet. Hi Geeta, I understand your concern regarding your daughter, that she's 14 years old and her periods have not started. The age of the period starting, or what we say the menarche is the time when the periods start, in today's affluent society may be anything between 9 years to say 14 years, 15 years. I would definitely say that 16 years and above is something to be concerned about if the periods don't start. This is something called primary amenorrhea, or that the girl has not gotten her periods at all. What I suggest at this stage you can do is that get her evaluated by a gynecologist regarding why her periods have not come. When you are evaluating her by a gynecologist, the gynecologist will do a complete health checkup of your child. She will see the breast development, axillary pubic hair development. There is something called a Tanner's classification, in which we classify the sexual age of the girl. After that, after evaluation of these things clinically, the doctor would probably do some tests on your child to know whether, you know, her hemoglobin is okay, her thyroid profile, her other hormonal profile, and do a sonography also. After doing all these tests, it will be easy for us to come to a diagnosis whether this is just a case of delayed periods. She may menstruate in a few months to a year. Otherwise, whether there's any pathology actually happening in her case as to, you know, pathological primary amenorrhea, as to why the menses have not started, is there really something to worry about? So don't worry about your daughter. Take her to the gynec as soon as possible and let her get herself evaluated. My next viewer, Reema, has asked the issue of frequent urinary issues. So I guess by this question is what she wants to ask Reema is that you are getting frequent urinary infections. Frequent urinary infections in the reproductive age group or in the pubertal age group, even in the perimenopausal, menopausal age group, that means in all age groups, the question of frequent urination is a very, very frequent urinary infection, is a very common problem. The basic reason for this is that the female urethra is a very small structure and it is, you know, it is very near the external opening. And what happens, we are very prone for, as women, very prone for urinary infections. Here, one thing is the basic hygiene. As you know, when you're using the washroom, I need not tell all my lovely friends here that, you know, the using the public toilets, flushing them, cleaning them before going, cleaning yourself before and after you pass urine. And you may be having some symptoms of vaginal discharge or infections because of sexual intercourse also. This is also one of the reasons for urinary infections. Frequent urinary infections are because of decreased immunity. So your decreased immunity may be because you might be having some medical conditions, you might be anemic. Sexual intercourse itself may lead to urinary infections. Your partner may have some infection or some urinary infection himself. We usually tell the women to clean the urinary tract and the outside, urinary tract in the sense the external urethra and the vulva after, before and after intercourse, and drinking plenty of water throughout the day. The other reasons for frequent urinary infections may be some pre-diabetic conditions, some thyroid problems, some problems which are related in IUCD users. That means intrauterine contraceptive device users also have this problem of frequent urination because the thread which is there in the vagina is itself sometimes a means of bacterial vaginosis or frequent urinary tract infections. What I would advise all my viewers is that you should drink at least 3 to 4 liters of water daily. Maintain a good hydration. Boost up your immunity. Try and see that you lead a very healthy lifestyle. Keep your weight in check. Eat good nutritive food so that you're energetic and keep your hemoglobin and thyroid and other disorders like diabetes in check if you have them. Have frequent health checkups and urinary evaluations also can be done by urine routines and cultures and by sonographies in which we can see whether you are suffering from some renal stones which are causing repeated urinary tract infections, or there is some chronic bladder inflammation or cystitis as we call it, in which, you know, may have to give you long-term urinary antibiotics. The next viewer is, the next viewer's question, Azan Sheikh, says that I am 54 and there is a menopause issue. What I understand from this question, Azan, is probably that you have not attained menopause and you are 54 years of age. Usually, menopause means the complete cessation of periods for the whole duration should be 1 year. Within a year, within that complete year, you should not have had menstruation. So that is the definition of menopause. In the Indian context, the menopause age is anything between 50 plus minus 2. Sometimes the age of menopause may be related or may be according to your genetic or familial history. We usually ask the woman whether her mother, sisters, or any cousins have had menopause earlier or a little later. That means early menopause before the age of 45 or 40, late menopause after the age of say 52 or 54. So probably in your case it might be that it might have a familial history to it, that your mothers or your sisters had a late menopause. In case the menopause is not occurring say maybe within a year, what you can do is that you can go to the gynecologist and get yourself completely checked up to to rule out any pathological or medical conditions which are delaying your menopause, and get a sonography done to check out if the organs and everything is internally, all the organs are normal or not. Otherwise, I think Arzan, don't, there is no issue here, and don't get disturbed because of this. You might be one of those women who are going to have their menopause a little late, maybe probably 54 or 56. So I don't think that you should worry excessively for the same. The next viewer is question from Neela. The question is, in this month I got my periods on time, but only on the first day. There was a little bleeding and then the bleeding stopped. This has happened for the first time, and is this a major concern? Hi Neelam, your question is very pertinent, and we get many young women in our OPD, in our general daily practice, who are really worried. You know, doctor, my periods were absolutely regular, I used to get a good flow, and then suddenly, you know, this month my period was less. And in your case, of course, this has happened only for the first time, so I think that you should not worry. Sometimes, see, all the period issues are all usually related. The hormones are usually released from the brain. They act on the ovaries, and then the ovarian hormones are released. Many a times, just because of simple conditions like stress, undue exertion, some fever, some course of antibiotics you may have had, prolonged illness sometimes, you know, prolonged viral fever, or sometimes a heavy course of some antibiotics, or you were not well, or you were disturbed, or something like that, excessive traveling, there might be some amount of hormonal imbalance, and then the periods, you know, kind of either are delayed or they are excessive, or like in your case, the bleeding was there only for one day and then it has stopped. But here the concern would not be of only for one this month in which your periods came less, but you have to maintain a menstrual calendar henceforth and see whether the even simple things like weight gain may be the reason for less period. You know, sometimes, or in vice versa, is that supposing you have been exercising too much, okay, the hormones are dependent upon so many conditions. So what here I would advise is that don't worry for just because of this one period. But what you can do is that henceforth you can maintain a menstrual calendar. If the periods every month are coming very scantily, or if they are getting delayed, then that may be the start of a hormonal imbalance which might affect your ovaries and lead to other conditions like small follicular cysts on the ovaries, which we commonly call polycystic ovaries, or some anovulation or ovulatory problems. So here, maintain a proper weight and diet chart, as I've been telling you all from the beginning of my talk, is that simple things like sedentary lifestyle, obesity, gaining weight, also may start in the form of some irregular menses, like, you know, just a little bit of scanty bleeding, and then later on your periods don't come, they get delayed. So this would be if in later months also the same thing recurs, then it might be the start of something which you can easily cure and easily handle yourself. The next question is from Lisa. Her age is 25. She says, I have PCO for 4 years. The doctor prescribed me some pills and I was taking this for a long time, though there was a gap in between the treatment course. Now I am not taking medicines anymore and the cysts have become physiological. But again I am facing irregular menstruation, hirsutism, gained extra weight than normal, which is around 4-5 kilos. And what can I do now to solve these problems? It would be very kind of you to give advice as to what I should do now. Liza, if you've heard my talk right from the beginning, I have kind of stressed on polycystic ovaries and hormonal imbalance, and how we are frequently facing these problems from young girls regarding irregular menstruation and PCOS. So here again, the problem here is because all of you are studying or you are doing your jobs and you don't get time, enough time to, you know, really regulate your weight and your diet and your exercise, what is happening is more and more girls like you are coming for these problems which you have just mentioned. Irregular menstruation with hirsutism, that is unwanted hair, acne, obesity, weight gain, These are all a problem of multifactorial problem of polycystic ovaries, in which there are many, many symptoms like this, and it becomes a metabolic syndrome. So here what happens is that basically the first thing we advise you as gynecologist and to help you, the doctor would say that again, a proper weight and diet chart, what is, how much your BMI should be for that much height and weight. Accordingly, how much you should reduce your weight. If you have a sedentary lifestyle, at least 30 to 40 minutes of brisk walking or any type of exercise for 3-4 to 5 days in a week. Minimum 3 to 4 days in a week, brisk walking and exercise. Healthy, nutritious diet. You can take a chart from the dietitian. So this is the mainstay of treatment of PCO. Now, after doing all the investigations and seeing how severe the PCO is, if the menstruation periods are very, very prolonged or they are not coming on time, like 2 or 3 months, and the cysts are increasing in size, there are the polycystic ovaries has increased, then at that time what we do is, like you had been prescribed pills by your previous gynec, the same thing we would do, that you know, for a temporary period of time we would put you on hormonal pills, either estrogen progesterone combination or only progesterone pills, so that the periods are regularized. And in the meantime, we give you time so that whatever lifestyle problems are there, you can modify those. And maybe later on, after stopping these pills, you might revert back to the normal menstrual pattern which you should have. Sometimes what happens in PCO patients is that for that temporary period of time that we are giving them the hormones, their menses are regular. Afterwards, after stopping the hormones, again they say, doctor, my periods again have become irregular, what to do? I know this problem is faced by many and it is a very frustrating problem. Sometimes here we are doing, there is something in polycystic ovaries is which the androgen hormone, that is the male hormone, testosterone also, and prolactin or insulin is raised. Most of the literature says that polycystic ovaries is because of excess of androgen and insulin. So there is insulin resistance in your body, which is either familial, genetic, or because of some lifestyle change. Now here what happens, many of the young women, they would, in such a case if the serum insulin is high, they would get better treatment options and they would respond to the treatment better if we give them, along with the hormonal support, some anti-diabetic treatment which would decrease their insulin resistance. So these are these anti-diabetic medicines also, which, you know, when you tell this to a young girl or a person in the reproductive age group, they are kind of shocked. Doctor, I am not diabetic, I only have irregular periods, what are you saying? This is because then you have to explain to them is that because of the insulin resistance, it will be good to see that you reduce your insulin resistance, which is the basic mainstay problem of PCO. And then once we treat the main problem of PCO, then your periods automatically become regular. So I would suggest that you visit your gynec and talk this and discuss this with her, and then this advice can be followed. The next question is by Sarah. She says, do birth control pills lead to any issues to the genitals? Sarah, the birth control pills, if taken for a longer time, can lead to dryness in the vaginal area. And that may cause some issues when you are having intercourse. Because of the dryness issues, this may lead to some amount of pain during the intercourse or dry vagina and the vulvar area. Other than this, any issues to the genitals, what I gauge from this question is that whether there is any long-term effect of the oral contraceptive pills on the, or birth control pills on the ovaries or the uterus. Here, the answer is no, because the birth control pills temporarily, till you are taking them, would act on the ovulation and stop the ovulation temporarily. The moment you stop the birth control pills, then the ovulation just bounces back. And you can, if you're wanting a pregnancy, a month or so later after the stoppage of the birth control pills, you can go ahead and try to conceive. There would be no problem. birth control pills on the if they're taken for a long time. Sometimes in some women they may lead to a little weight gain, so we have to be careful about that. And some amount of dryness or vaginal infections because of the dryness which is coming up. But otherwise, birth control pills are quite safe if the proper lifestyle is maintained. The next question is from from Sakshi. Are supplements safe for our gynec care? Supplements, the safety of supplements, these supplements, I think what you mean and what you want to ask is calcium supplements, iron supplements. The test, if they are required, they must be given, and I assure you that they will be very safe. Zainab's question is, my daughter is 9 years old. How should I educate her about personal hygiene? So Zainab, this is a very good question, and the way to educate your daughter regarding personal hygiene would be, because she is going to school and she may soon start her menses. So regarding there, in such young girls in schools, the washrooms and all may not be very clean. So such girls would sometimes have repeated urinary tract infections also. What I would suggest to tell your daughter is that the area, the vaginal area, the genital area should be cleaned from above downwards. That is very important thing to educate a young girl, because if she cleans from below upwards, she's carrying the germs from the anus to the upper part, that is the urethra and the vaginal area, because of which she might have some infections and some itching. Secondly is that you have to teach her that when she should drink a lot of water. There should be a lot of water intake in general, and when she's going to the washroom, of course, as we tell each and every person in that age group, is that you have to clean the area from above downwards and drink a lot of water so that you're not suffering from any urinary infections. When you have to educate her regarding her menstruation also, now she'll be entering the age in which the menstruation will start. So here she has to be taught a little bit about the genital organs, what causes menstruation, what starts, and how she should be using her pads, and how that area should be kept clean during the menstruation. The next question is from one of our viewers, who says that what are the adverse effects, should we change our diet to cure PCOD? So my friend, we have talked so much about PCOD today. I think I have also given you a lot of information about polycystic ovarian disorder or disease or syndrome, as we call it. And throughout my talk, I think I have stressed a lot on diet and exercise to manage PCOD. I wouldn't really say to cure PCOD, but I would use the word to manage PCOD and to make your periods more regular, to increase your fertility by, the ovulation also. It helps ovulation and the period control by stressing on your diet and your exercise. So here in PCOD also, lean PCODs or obese PCODs, for both, the change in their diet, less of carbs, less of sugars, sugar and salt, less of that, less of carbs and fats. So that would definitely, more of vitamins, proteins, minerals. This would definitely help to increase your intent to manage the PCO and get it under control very soon. Here what we say is that you should have small frequent meals. The breakfast should be the biggest meal. Then you can eat your lunch in the proper manner, and it should be a little lesser than the breakfast. Breakfast should be the healthiest meal of the day and the biggest meal of the day, followed by lunch and dinner. Dinner should be very minimum, with less of carbs and sugars, and try and eat at least by 7 or 8 p.m. I know everyone nowadays has a everyone is trying to maintain a healthy lifestyle, but because of our stresses in our jobs, we are unable to eat at the right time. We are not drinking enough water. There are so many other things because of which we are not exercising a lot. So the diet definitely helps. The diet change to a healthier diet with less of carbs and sugars will definitely help to manage your PCOD, also your periods and your ovulation. So I think the other question which was asked by Zainab is that the diet recommendations for women in their early and mid 30s to maintain a good gynec. So this probably I hope I have managed to answer that question as per your satisfaction. There is one question by advocate Sapna Mishra who says that after my hysteroscopy, I get spotting for 10 days after my period. Why is this? So Sapna, basically here the question comes as to why the hysteroscopy was performed, whether it was for menstrual issue or fertility issue, whether it was a diagnostic hysteroscopy or a therapeutic hysteroscopy because you had maybe a polyp inside, or what was the reason for doing the hysteroscopy, or whether it was for for menstrual complaints, heavy periods. So here my answer would be incomplete, or I would not be able to answer this in the correct manner, because I need to know several things: whether your hysteroscopy was done for what reason, then only this the reason for spotting after your periods would be I could solve that. So maybe if you could put in more input on this, then I'll be able to solve that question in a better manner. So the next questions is question by again by Zainab is, what are the reasons for low period flow? So here, low period flow, as one other viewer had also asked, that for one day she had a lesser period. So I have told her, of course, that you maintain your menstrual flow and see whether this period is going to revert back to normal. But the one of the reasons for low period flow is progesterone hormone. See what happens in our menstrual cycle. There are two hormones which are governing the entire 30 or 28 days of our cycle. There are two hormones in the female body which have to be in balance: estrogen and progesterone. So here, in a very, very simple way, I would like to tell you, if the estrogen is more and the progesterone is low, there goes the cycle. Cycle is not going to be in balance. Cycle will be in balance only when the estrogen and progesterone are in proper amounts during the cycle of the woman. And the ovulation is banned one time, 14-15 day, for a 28 to 30 days cycle. So here what happens post ovulation, if the progesterone is low, then what happens, that cycle either it becomes delayed or there is low flow. So basically the hormonal imbalance between estrogen and progesterone, estrogen high, progesterone little low, okay, then you're not ovulating on time, then the periods are also not coming regularly, periods are coming scanty. Now what is the reason for this hormonal imbalance? As I have repeatedly told you in our talk, I think is that because of lifestyle, sudden weight gain or obesity, or then you have polycystic ovaries, which is again a lifestyle problem of hormones, or there is some problem in the other problems, most of the problems are because of hormonal imbalance, but there might be other problems like ovarian cysts or fibroids, which are also again causing some hormonal issues and some problems in the menstruation. So, but basically the reason for low period flow would be some progesterone or hormonal imbalance. Preeti Verma says, ma'am, please tell us how to maintain good gynae health and conceive easily. So Preeti, the main reason why we have all gathered here today on the occasion of Women's Day is to educate you regarding why gynec screening is so important. So here at the outset itself, I have told all my lovely viewers is that to maintain a good gynae health, sometimes some gynae concerns just pop up uninvited. So what happens in such a case, you're not well equipped to deal with them because you don't know your body, your genital system, and what are the regular things that you should be doing. So here, to maintain a good gynae health is basically to keep your weight and diet in check. Your BMI should be between 18 to 25. You should be drinking a lot of water, keep yourself well hydrated, exercise regularly, eat a balanced, healthy and nutritious diet. And if you want to conceive, then it is very important to do a preconceptional counseling by your gynecologist and some preconceptional checkups, in which we check many of the hormones, many of the nutrient deficiencies, some vitamin deficiencies, and we put all our preconceptional age group women, we tell them to take folic acid with B12. It is very important for you to start folic acid 5 milligrams on a daily basis, 1 to 3 months prior to conception. This is because folic acid is one of the key supplements to prevent neural tube defects in your baby, that is spinal cord defects in the baby. So that is one thing. And the other reason for giving folic acid in B12 is to supplement the body with this. So it is very important to keep in good gynae health preconceptionally. Divya says, is it safe, madam, to take painkillers during periods? So here, Divya, the painkillers which would usually we advocate during periods is something like, you know, tablet. You must have heard of tablets like Meftal-Spas, or simple tablets like paracetamol or brufen, or the combination like combiflam. So, or buscopan, which is antispasmodic, you know, cyclopam or buscopan. So these tablets are safe during periods to some extent. A period pain, which usually may last for a day or two, you can start some tablets just before the pain starts, so that, you know, you're combating the pain easily. Now here, again, I would like to stress on dysmenorrhea or painful periods. The basic cause of painful periods, you know, young girls, all of them, you know, most of them suffer from period pain. This period pain is usually normal because the girl is young, the muscles around the cervix is very tight. You know, we say that after the normal delivery or after pregnancy, when all the tissues have become a little lax and a little loose, the cervical fibers around your cervix will, the fibers around your cervix will kind of loosen up a bit, and that dysmenorrhea or painful periods will reduce. But the other reasons for painful periods might be severe vitamin D deficiency, which needs to be addressed. There might be pathological conditions for painful periods like endometriosis or fibroids or ovarian cysts. So basically, if the period pain is very mild and it is easily treatable by painkillers, there is no harm in taking painkillers for a few days, once or twice a day. But if this pain is very severe, which is not responding to painkillers, then it might be some pathological pain because of the reasons which I told you. And then regarding this, you should be investigating and meeting your gynec. Hello ma'am, Shalini says, is it possible to conceive in case of fibroids in uterus? So Shalini, the topic of fibroids is also so big that it will be difficult for me to tell you in a few lines, but don't worry. It is definitely, you will be able to conceive even if there is a fibroid in the uterus, because it is essential to know where is the fibroid. There are various types of fibroid. Subserous means outside the uterus, intramural means within the walls, or submucous means the fibroid is inside the uterus. So here, the fertility would depend on the number of fibroids, the size of the fibroids, and where they are placed, the location of the fibroids. Depending upon that, the fibroids which are small fibroids in the wall, or those fibroids which are outside the uterus, may not affect the conception part or the fertility at all. If the fibroids are inside the uterus, then definitely those type of fibroids will have to be removed, and the whole endometrial cavity will have to be kind of, you know, cleaned, so that the endometrium is prepared in response for the conception purpose. So don't worry, meet your gynec and she'll tell you more about the fibroids, where your fibroids are, by sonography, maybe by some other test like hysteroscopy, and then they can be treated if required, and there'll be no problem during conception. Sarah Tejani says, Doctor, I have a friend who has a minor cyst in both the ovaries and borderline PCOS. Years of treatment have gone in vain. What would be your advice to her? So here, Sarah, first thing I would like to know is the what is your friend's age? And these minor cysts in both the ovaries, that means you're talking about the polycystic ovaries, in which what would be your advice to her regarding fertility, as I can see what you want to ask. So here what happens is that because of polycystic ovaries, many a times the visit to the fertility specialist becomes a must in these cases, because she has to see some of the hormonal levels like AMH hormone, prolactin, and other hormones which are related to fertility. Here they stimulate the ovaries, and the fertility methods are there in which there are so many good technologies and methods today in which, you know, the treatment can be given and the very good fertility rates are there. For even for those women who have lot of small follicles in the ovaries and they are not able to conceive. So that, and another thing is that years of treatment here, Sara, I must know that whether this treatment your friend wants is regarding fertility treatment or regarding only the period issues or the obesity issues. So here, a little more clarification would be required by the gynec as to what type of treatment has gone in vain. Whether she had gone for a fertility treatment, because nowadays the technology is so good that most of the PCO patients, even if they are very severe PCOs, they do respond to the treatment very well. Taranpreet says that when can we expect periods to start post-pregnancy while nursing full-time? So Taranpreet, here there is no particular period in which we can say, you know, that even if you're fully breastfeeding, your periods will or will not start. Usually the start of periods after the pregnancy and being a full-time, I mean being a completely or exclusively breastfeeding mother, the periods may start anytime. Sometimes a particular woman who is breastfeeding her child fully, she may get her periods. The pattern may be that she's getting her periods every month, or the pattern may be that she's getting her periods irregularly every 2 to 3 months, or the pattern may be that she's not getting her periods at all. 6 months to a year is acceptable. After a year, usually I tell my patients that maybe we can go in for a sonography and see whether there's any other particular problem which is associated and why you're not getting your periods. Sometimes those patients who are already PCO patients who have had irregular periods before their pregnancy, or hypothyroid patients who are already on treatment before their pregnancy or during the pregnancy for thyroid problems, may develop postpartum thyroiditis also, and they may not get their periods regularly. If you're not getting your periods and if everything is normal for a year, that is absolutely acceptable. But later on, after a year, we must check with sonography and the thyroid levels and other levels as to if there is anything else which is a problem. Otherwise, I don't think that for 6 months to a year there is any need to get worried. The other question which I'm taking up is by Rupani, when can we have regular relationship with partner after a normal delivery with stitches? Hi Rupani, here the episiotomy or the stitches which you are talking about after the normal delivery, the how the stitches are, you know, how the stitches heal, the relation, I mean the post and I mean post the episiotomy and the delivery, the stitches usually take anywhere between 2 weeks to 4 weeks to heal. Depends on whether they have any infection or anything. About 2 to 4 weeks is the general time for the stitches to heal. So here, after the stitches have healed, the uterus, after any type of delivery, whether it is normal or cesarean, takes about 6 weeks to heal. So 6 weeks to heal in the sense that it becomes a normal pelvic organ by 6 weeks. 6 weeks to 8 weeks is the time for the full convalescence for a normal delivery with the stitches healing absolutely. So after that, that is approximately 8 weeks postpartum, you can have a normal relationship with your husband. When can we expect periods? So again, Rupali, this question was again asked by Taranjit as to when, Taranpreet, as to when the periods can come back after the normal delivery or normal cesarean section delivery. So here I have already answered that. Taranpreet again asks whether it is safe to use tampons, or another question of the same variety is, are menstrual cups safe? So here, menstrual cup, which is the cup which is, you know, covering the cervix, or tampons, which are the tampons which are covering the vaginal portion of the genital area for menstrual hygiene and for menstrual periods. See, both these menstrual cups and the tampons are very good for those who are, especially for those women who are having heavy periods. It is very, very easy, especially the type of clothes we are wearing when we are going to the office and all. It is very easy and good to use menstrual cups or tampons because the pads might be quite inconvenient. So only the only safety measures which are to be, you know, taken with the tampons or menstrual cups is that they should be changed every 4 to 6 hours. Sometimes when you are busy and you've forgotten to change, then what happens that they can, the menstrual hygiene is disrupted and they can, you can develop some infections because of the tampons or the menstrual cups remaining in the body for a longer time. So here I would suggest that, you know, regularly every 4 to 6 hours changing of the menstrual cups and cleaning that area would be advisable. Are there any gynec problems over the age of 40? This is one of the questions which has been asked by Zainab. So here, gynec problems over the age of 40. Again, 40, I would say 3 to 4 years before the menopause is the area which is called the perimenopausal age group. Over the age of 40, okay, 10 years for you to go into the menopausal area. But after you have completed your childbearing, the various problems which can be encountered is, again, you know, some irregularity in the periods because of hormonal imbalance, maybe because of slight or generally, you know, slight amount of weight gain, or, you know, at that time the exercise problem has, exercising has reduced and then you're gaining a little bit of weight, your hormones are getting irregular. So these problems may be there in the age group above 40. Then again, fertility issues might be there in those women who are coming to us at a later age group. So above 40, again, fertility issues, and those who want to conceive, so we have to go into the details of that problem also. Other problems which a person of over 40 years age group may encounter are endometriosis or ovarian cysts or fibroids. So these are the common problems which we may see at that age. So, is there any other time to take more questions?
Yeah.
So, I just take one more question before I conclude. What could be possibly the causes of bleeding between periods? It's a very good question to ask. The problems of, there may be many reasons for bleeding between periods. So this bleeding may either be because of, you might be having some local polyps, cervical polyps, endometrial polyps, some growths on the genital area. So growths may be non-cancerous, they may be cancerous growths. So non-cancerous growth or cancerous growth may lead to some bleeding between the periods. Bleeding between the periods can also be due to polycystic ovaries or ovarian cysts because of hormonal imbalance, fibroids in the uterus. But basically, there might be some other problems also which are localized to the cervical region, like cervical erosion, cervical polyps. And all these things need to be evaluated in detail and sorted out. So the other question which has come up is, will endometriosis pain go away once one hits menopause? You very rightly asked this question. Endometriosis is basically a problem because of estrogen and the hormones in general. So endometriosis is one such condition which definitely after menopause it will become less. It will become less like fibroids, because once you hit menopause, your estrogen progesterone levels are going to go down. And then once they go down and once they are, you know, very, very low, the endometriosis which had flared up because of the estrogen will definitely go down. So I think it is time for me to conclude today's session. So I hope all my viewers were happy with the answers that I could give them. I know that all their anxieties and their queries have not been answered in one go, because naturally, if for each and every detailing, it will be difficult for me to detail the questions, because some of the, we need to know a little bit more about their, you know, we need to examine you and need to know so much more about your conditions. So I would advise you to, you know, get yourself checked and get yourself treated by your local gynec. So here, basically, on the occasion of Women's Day, my concluding remark for today would be that why should we go in for the gynec screening regularly? It is very important for you to visit your gynec in all the age groups for a general gynecological consultation for your general gynec health. So it would be really good to know that you are maintaining a good general gynec hygiene, menstrual hygiene. You're visiting your gynec regularly to get assistance with your menstrual periods, for your pelvic examinations, for birth control, for urinary related issues, for breast examinations, and to prevent all the problems that everyone is going to face later on. So we want this world to be full of healthy and lovely women like you. So let me again wish you a very happy Women's Day. This is Dr. Mini Salunke from Cloudnine Hospital, Kalyani Nagar, Pune. Thank you so much.